Hey guys, it's Peter, and welcome to my channel, Peterisms, where I tell stories of my life and just little things that I've learned as I have grown into the person that I am today. And on my main channel today, my Petermon channel, I did a video talking about body image and body acceptance and other people's perceptions of that. And so, you know, since it is something that I have struggled with, honestly, my entire life, I thought I would kind of tell a little bit of my story over here. Now, I have done an entire video talking about my journey with weight loss, my journey with weight gain, and I will link it at the end of this video so that you guys can go check that out if you haven't seen it already. But I think that one of the things that I have learned in my life is this, is that, you know, when we talk about body positivity and self-concept, I do not care for the word self-esteem. I like self-concept better. When we talk about, you know, self-concept and body positivity and accepting our bodies and things like that, that is not the same thing as talking about weight. And I think that it's something that, you know, we kind of forget at times. You know, when we talk about body positivity, we immediately go to somebody who we think is overweight. We don't talk about the people that really struggle gaining weight. We don't talk about things like, you know, people that are improportionate in size, as I am. You know, my thighs are very, very thick. I gain all of my weight in my thighs, in my butt, and in my stomach. And so I can sit on camera like this to you, and you guys can go, well, you really don't look that heavy, Peter, because I get that comment a lot. But if I stood up, or if you met me in person, you would say, oh, like, I can tell that you're heavier than I thought you were. But it's not just about weight, you know? It's about all kinds of things. One of my biggest issues with body positivity was me feeling the need to color my hair from the time that I was 23 until 39 years old. And my hair started turning gray very, very early. It turned gray right around a year after I got sober. So 23 and a half, almost 24 years old, I started noticing not just a little, but a lot of gray. And it started coming right here to my temples, and then it spread up. And the hairstylist that I was going to at the time said, you know, why don't we just color your hair, see if you like it. If you don't, you can let it grow out. And what ended up happening was, you know, 23 to 39 years old. So 16 years of me getting my hair colored every 3 to 4 weeks because my hair was so short, it grew out very fast. That's expensive care for body positivity. And I think a lot of you out there will probably relate to the expense that it costs to keep up with looking youthful, or at least looking the way that makes you happy in size, or inside, or in size. But that is not just about weight, you know? That can be anything from your nose to, there was a long time where I was very, very self-conscious of my nose. And, you know, I thought it was really, really big and I didn't really like it. And in fact, I talked about this on my other channel, but my dad is a plastic surgeon. And, you know, I would always want him to refer me to somebody for a rhinoplasty, for a nose job. And he would say, I don't really think that's what you want to do. I think 10 or 12 years down the road, you'll regret that. You know, but if you want to go, and this was after I was 18 years old, he said, if you want to go, you know, for an evaluation, I'm more than willing to, you know, set you up with somebody. I never ended up doing that. And I've never had any plastic surgery. I wouldn't rule it out if it was something that I felt like I wanted to do. 6 weeks before my wedding, I got some Botox right here and right here and around my eyes. And I have to say that at that time, it really did make me feel a lot younger. I mean, it was pretty miraculous, the results that I got from it. And not, you know, initially, it took, you know, I think a week for me to really notice the full difference. But I have this line right here that, you know, if you see it goes that way, and then I have a line right here. And those lines are there because of my facial expressions. I then got Botox a second time, I would say 2 years after that, and in the same exact spots. And that time, my eyes really arched up, and I felt like I kind of looked like I belonged on that TV show Botched. So at that point, I was like, you know, I don't think I'm going to do this anymore. And I had seen an interview with Diane Keaton on Oprah years before where Oprah had asked her if she had ever had any plastic surgery, and she said no. And she said that she, you know, wasn't against it, but that for her, she believed in aging authentically. And I really, really, really liked that idea. And, you know, since I talked a lot about my dad and the cosmetic surgery on my other channel, I'm not going to get into a lot of that on here. But I grew up with a father, you know, that did cosmetic surgery for a living. And he no longer does. But I don't know that his attitude has changed a whole lot. And something that I said over there that I'll say here is that, you know, my dad always told me that, like, 80% of the people that get cosmetic surgery, most of the world can't even tell that they've had it. It's really for them and building their own confidence because it's in their psyche that, you know, a lot of cosmetic changes that we have are really to match how we feel inside or to deal with our own self-concept because we feel less than in some area than others. So then really what the work would be to work on those issues with ourselves. And then if we still want to get the work done, that's great too. It's the same thing as dieting and running and working out, you know? And in my life, there have been two times that I have been the lowest in weight and maintained my weight for a very, very long period of time. The first time was when I did Weight Watchers, and although I'm not doing Weight Watchers now, I'm a firm supporter on Weight Watchers, and I'm not sponsored or anything like that, just because it worked so well for me. It worked very well for me to understand the food that I was eating. It worked for me as far as understanding what I could eat for my weight size, my weight type, and it worked for me as far as helping me maintain it long after I stopped doing Weight Watchers. The second one was when I was a vegetarian. And I was running every day and I was lifting weights 3 times a week. And to me, that is called a lifestyle. And, you know, I think for me, having to have a lifestyle in my life that isn't going out to eat, eating junk food and all that kind of stuff. And if you watch my vlogs, I'm not a good eater. I'm a food addict, you know? And, but being a food addict doesn't mean that I can't have body positivity at the same time. Body positivity, as far as my weight, is me standing in the closet and looking at the clothes that I have and being like, I can't even fit into these things that I bought 2 years ago. And getting really sad as a result of that, or going to a store and seeing something that I want to buy and not even wanting to shop because as soon as I put it on, I feel like I look like a potato. And I'm sure there's some people out there that, you know, relate to that. So really, my body positivity is in relation to other people, to the clothing that is put out, to the things I see in magazines, you know, which I've grown up with always looking at fashion magazines and things like that. You know, GQ back in the day used to kill me because I would look in there and it was like every cologne ad was a man that was just chiseled. Well, you know, like that's Instagram today. Every Instagram picture is a guy that's in great shape. And, you know, for the women out there that, you know, watch beauty influencers, I'm sure a lot of you have come from my channel for that. And watch all, you know, we are inundated with this idea of what beauty is in our society. And I really am a firm believer, and you know this, that beauty comes from the inside out. That being said, for many of us, let's not bullshit. When we look in the mirror, we don't feel beautiful. And body positivity can't just be looking in the mirror and saying, but you're a really good person. You're really beautiful inside and out. And I think it's about being realistic about what you're okay with, what makes you feel desirable to your partner or to anybody. You know, what makes you feel good enough when you wake up in the morning that you're okay with who you are. That isn't necessarily about any standard of weight. You know, somebody could be 300 pounds, somebody could be 120 pounds, somebody else could be 6 foot, you know, seven, and it just doesn't matter. But I think it's all about acceptance and comparison is what it's about, you know? And I've had to really learn to not compare myself to other people because my journey is totally different. And the things that I need to learn along the way are totally different. And although I continue to struggle with my weight, which is my biggest issue with body positivity, I can talk about the hair and I can talk about the nose and I can talk about the beard and I can talk about all of it, right? But my biggest issue with body positivity and body acceptance has always been my weight. I've struggled with it for, you know, 30 plus years, longer than that now, you know? And so every time I do a video about my weight, I always get all these comments and people are like, well, you should do this or you should do that or blah, 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 blah. Or they say something very negative. And there's nothing that you can say that I haven't already said to myself at one time or another. There's nothing that anybody can say to me about my weight or about how I feel about my weight that I haven't already said to myself. So those things really aren't painful for me anymore. They just aren't. They're almost kind of more assurances of what I already believed. And I think for me, what I've really been working on lately, okay, as I have been trying to eat certain things that are healthier, is that where can I get to a point where I can wake up and I can walk in that closet and just be okay? You know, where can I wake up on a daily basis and I don't feel like I need to fix myself? I don't feel like I need to do something because I have to be honest, sometimes when I was running every day and I was working out, it never was enough. And I look back, you know, in my life, and I'll be really honest with you, I weigh about 240 pounds right now, and that's really heavy, okay, for somebody that's 5'10 and a half. But I look back at 220 and at 218, and I know 218 because 218 was the last weight that I was able to wear my wedding band. And so I always think to myself, if I could get back to 218 again, I could wear my wedding band. And everybody's like, well, go get it sized and go get it sized down so you can wear it. And for me, it, you know, it's, and this is kind of a sad commentary on my life. It's like motivation genes, you know, that you have, those inspiration genes that you want to get into. So you keep on aiming for that weight so you can wear those jeans. That is for me with my wedding band. And I know at some point I will get there. I just don't know when. But I'm sure that I will. I know that about myself. But, you know, I look back at 220, 218, 210, I was 190 when I got married, you know, 185, 170, 165, 150, 135. Can you believe my license, driver's license said 135 for a long time until I went to go renew it, and the woman looked at me and she said, no offense, but you're not 135. I was like, what? And I wasn't. I was a good 200 at that point, you know, and, but I think we start thinking that way. But you know what's interesting is when I look back, and I don't know if anybody relates to this, and this is where the food addict part really does come in, and the lack of acceptance, and this is something I've been working on in counseling, the lack of acceptance of who I am inside and out, is that at any of those weights, I never really woke up and felt like I'm done. Like, I'm where I want to be, you know, I feel the best I need to be, and that's the food addict part of me. You know, that's the addict that one is too many and a thousand is never enough, that it's never going to be enough. And so for me to get to a point where I am okay with myself, and this is me owning my truth, okay? Me getting on camera and telling my truth so that I can go back and go, well, you made the video, so this is your truth, Peter. The truth for me is I have to work on those issues of the addiction, because it's not about food to me. It's not about weight. It's about accepting those things that are underlying that food addiction for me. And, you know, and they are different. And it's easy to, you know, I've talked a lot on here about my addiction with, you know, drugs and alcohol. But the things that spurn both of those are completely, completely different. They really are. And, you know, I've worked on so many of my issues with my drug. I mean, it's been 23 and a half years. There's not really anything I haven't worked on at this point. But, you know, with my food addiction, I look back and I look at the times, like, I ate emotionally when I was growing up. You know, if I came home and I was sad from school, my mom was like, let's make graham cracker cookies with frosting and graham crackers. You know, if it was a holiday or a celebration, I celebrated with food. You know, and I would always, like, walk away with that feeling remorseful, because I would never just have one graham cracker, you know, cookie. I would always have 15. And that's how I've always eaten. I've always been quality, not quantity. And, you know, my friends have known for years and years and years, long before I was a vegetarian, that I love bar food more than anything else. Chicken fingers, nachos, fries, onion rings, that's where I'm in heaven. And the thing is that food is very much a drug for me in that moment. I feel so elated and so good. But when I walk away and I feel bloated and I feel remorseful, and I'm like, God, what did you just do? And start over tomorrow. I'm going to start over tomorrow, right? And the reality is that I've had to learn that I can celebrate, like I did this last night. I can celebrate, you know, without having to have excess, you know? I usually only eat half my portions now. I usually, you know, only try, and this is not a weight loss channel. Again, I'm just not going to go back to that. But, you know, I'm doing the best that I can. And that's what I have to tell myself on a daily basis is, Peter, you're doing the best that you can. And one day you'll get there. You know, it's you're working towards that. And one day you will get there. And for me, the aging authentically part was a little bit of, you know, I had a conversation with my dad. My dad and I look very similar. He has a beard, a white beard. He has white hair. I have white hair. And he has steel blue eyes. I have steel blue eyes. We look very, very similar. And we were sitting out on his patio one day, and this was close to after I had gotten married, and my hair was kind of growing out a little bit. And I said, you know, Dad, I said, I don't really know what to do with my hair. Should I let it go? Should I keep it brown? And my dad sat back, and he said, you know, Pete, he goes, my dad calls me Pete. He goes, just let it go. He goes, what are you going to do? Try to keep up with 23 for the rest of your life? He goes, just let it go. And he goes, you know, sometimes it's kind of fun to embrace a new part of your life. And I so agree with that. You know, it's like, there are times that I do think about going back and coloring my hair, but not often. It doesn't happen to me very often where I think I want to go back to brown. And what's happened over time is that I have stepped into this new person that has white hair, and I love it. And you know, what was interesting was before I colored my hair, people guessed me for 32 or 33, and like literally, and when I got my last bit of color cut out of my hairstylist was like, your hair is not all white, it can't possibly be. And I was like, yeah, it is. And she cut it out, she's like, your hair is really all, almost, my hair is not gray, it is white, okay? And people immediately guessed me from like, at 33, I was getting with brown hair, all the way here. I have a picture right here at my wedding. There's me 7 years ago with brown hair. People immediately guessed me for 50. I mean, immediately. And I'm like, I'm 39 years old. Do you know what I mean? And, but over time I kind of fell in love with this new Peter, and I kind of fell in love with the new hair. And it's interesting. Now I go places and people are like, I love your hair color. You know, what did you do to get your hair color? I'm like, it's called getting older. You know, you just, you can't really control that. And a lot of people are like, why is your mustache a different color? It's really not. It looks far away with the lights. It looks like it is, but up close, it's really not as different. But people are like, why is your mustache a different color than your beard? I don't know. I have no idea. I wish I knew, you know, the intricacies of the world like that. But I think that what I have learned over time is, you know, accepting things. I have very, very hairy legs, and it's the only part of my body that is hairy. And if you look even like on my arms, it's like the hair stops right here. And it was interesting because when I was in high school, it was something that like I didn't like about myself, you know? And I rarely wore shorts. I've talked about this on my vlog actually. And then one day I just started wearing shorts, and what was so interesting was women would stop me in gas stations and they would say, you have the sexiest legs, you know? And I was like, really? And they're like, oh yeah, like I like, and my legs are tree trunks. I love when Shane Dawson talks about that because my legs are exact, I feel the same way. But they're like, oh my God. And I just naturally have kind of muscular legs. I wish the rest of my body was naturally muscular. But you know, they're like, women are always like, yes, you have like very like masculine legs. And I never thought of it that way, you know? Like I just thought, I don't know. Like it was just something that I didn't like about myself. And a lot of times we cover up those parts of ourselves that we don't like instead of exposing those like parts that might be likable to somebody else. And we never know until we show that side of ourselves. And so I think a lot about body positivity is getting comfortable enough with ourselves to show who we are inside and out, not just physically, you know, and moving towards a goal that you want to have. I know for me with my weight, honest to God, I have a goal weight that I want to be. And, you know, I set the goal a year ago, 5 years ago, 6 years ago. I mean, I've set that goal millions of times, right? If I ever stuck to what I needed to do and didn't just think, Cheesecake Factory sounds good tonight, then I would lose the weight. If I started walking and running again, I would lose the weight. I know that. It's my own laziness. It's my own food addiction. It's really more laziness than anything else. Because I know what to do. Nobody needs to tell me what to do. I've done it before. I know what to do. And I know what to do to keep it off. And I know that if I ever got to that weight, I would feel very good about myself. But the reality is it wouldn't change who I am on the inside. It just wouldn't. And I could be 160 pounds and fit into everything in my closet. And if I wasn't okay with who I was on the inside, I still wouldn't be okay at 160 pounds wearing every bit of clothing that's there. So, you know, the thing I have to work on and the thing where I'm at today is that I feel pretty good about myself on the inside, you know? And that's the part of the food addiction that's kind of like I've worked on. And now it's just the stopping of the eating to quantity levels. And I've kind of gotten to a point where I haven't gained any. I like lose, you know, 6 pounds, gain 2, you know, lose 3, gain 4. I'm back and forth. And I'm okay with that right now. I don't want to be this weight forever, and I do have a plan, and we can talk about that at a later date. And I've said I have plans on here a million times before, so there are gonna be those of you out there that he said that before. Well, you know, we all have struggles in our life, we really do, and I'm not big for putting people in their place for their struggles. I'm there to support them in whatever they're going through. But I do think that positivity of our bodies, whatever that is, okay? Whether it's something to do with our face, whether it's something to do with our hair, whether it's something to do with our bodies, whether it's something to do with our legs, whatever our issues are that we do not feel okay with within ourselves, we have to come to terms with that on some level. And then if we still want to change it, it's absolutely okay. I love you guys, and I will see you tomorrow. Bye.